We're in Torah Tet Vav, Torah 15 in the Likutei Moharan, and it's called Ohr HaGanuz, the hidden light. And Rabbi Nachman begins this Torah with a pasuk in Shemot that Hashem promises Am Yisrael, and he says, V'atem tiyulim amnechet kohanim v'goy kadosh. Ve'ela devarim asher tedaber al b'nei Yisrael. And you will be a kingdom of priests, mamlechet kohanim, a kingdom of priests, v'goy kadosh, and a holy nation. So Rabbi Nachman starts off Torah Tet Vav, Torah 15, in Ot Aleph, and he says like this. מי שרוצה לטעום טעם אור הגנוז, היינו סודות התורה שהתגלה לעתיד לבוא, צריך להעלות מידת היראה לשורשה. If someone wants to taste and experience the taste of the hidden light, that what is the hidden light all about? The hidden light is the light that is hidden in the Torah. It's the light of the Eitz HaChaim. It's the first light that Hashem created in all of existence, that it says in Bereshit, it says that Hashem saw that this light was too good and too sweet for anyone that is unworthy to enjoy it. And so Hashem hid it for the tzaddikim in the next world. And where did He hide it? He hid it in the Torah. And He hid it as the secrets of the Torah, meaning The Zohar explains that the Torah is a body. The Torah has a body, is a, just like a person. All the parts that we have in every person, so does the Torah. Just like a person has clothing, outer clothing, and then there's the physical body, and then there's the inner part of the body, all the different systems that are going on, the hormonal system and the nervous system, everything that's going on inside the body, the inner organs, the outer part of the body, the inner part of the body, the physical part of the body, the spiritual part of the body, the 248 limbs and the 365 sinews or nerves. And then there's the soul within that. And in the soul itself, there are many levels until you get to the source of the soul, the innermost level of the soul. In the same way, the Zohar explains, you have all of these different parts in the Torah as well. And a person who learns the stories in the Torah and thinks that this is the Torah is very, very mistaken. He has not even touched the actual Torah yet, says the Zohar. The Zohar says much more sharp words against somebody who takes the stories of the Torah in their simple understanding and thinks that that's the actual Torah. But the point that the Zohar is saying is that the stories of the Torah are just the outer appearance of the Torah, the outer manifestation of this tremendous light called the Torah. And as the Torah travels, the millions of worlds that it travels from the highest place in the world of Atzilut, right? The Yesod Abba, Yesod of Chochmah is the Torah, until it is manifested and clothed in this physical world. So every world that it travels, every lower world, it becomes enclothed in another appearance and another in clothing, and finally it comes in the form that we have it today. And all the halachot of the Torah, the Zohar says, are the goof of the Torah. The halachot are the goof of the Torah. The secrets of the Torah are the soul, the neshama of the Torah. And so the Torah, the essence of the Torah, is the first light, the Ohr HaGanuz. It's the first, it's the Ohr, it's the essence of light. It says that with this light, Adam HaRishon could see from one end of the world to the other end of the world. What does that mean? So the simple first level understanding of that, right? If you're teaching a child what that means, they would imagine in their head something that is tremendously bright, a light that is so tremendously bright, maybe it's as powerful as an X-ray, that it can shine through matter, okay? And most people live their whole lives thinking that that's what it means, the first light, the hidden light. But according to the way Chassidut explains it and Kabbalah explains it, the first light, the essence of light, which is really the essence of the Torah, that Adam HaRishon could see from one end of the world to the other end of the world, what does that mean Kabbalistically, or according to Chassidut, according to the Baal Shem Tov? It means that with this light, you could see from directly through all of matter to the spirituality within everything, meaning everything in all of existence in the whole universe is really saturated with godliness. It's saturated with Hashem's presence. And the problem is that the physicality of things, the chitzoniyut, the outer aspect of things, the chomer, the chomeriyut, hides the elokut, it hides the godliness. And that's why people fall to all of the lusts and desires of this physical world on the one hand, right? And people fall to anxiety and fear and worries from things in this world as well. On the other hand, both of these failures, so to speak, or falls, stumbles, both of these stumbles come about because the physicality, the illusion of the physicality is so strong that it blocks us, blocks our vision from seeing through to the spirituality, to the true essence of existence, that all is good, all is perfect already now and already here, because Hashem is always here. And there's only Hashem. And therefore, when a person sees, let's say, something in this physical world that is attractive, and a person wants to go after that thing as a separate entity, and a person is desiring that thing as a separate entity, that's because they are drawn by the sparks of holiness within it. But the block of the physicality, the illusion of the physicality, is that those sparks of good that are shining seem to be separated from Hashem, right? It seems like they have to do with that separate aspect. And that's why a person falls to that. Something that a person is afraid of or worried about has a spark of godly awe, of the ira, the fear of Hashem. But the physicality, the gashmiut, the illusion of the physical world, is blocking the ability to see that. And that's why a person falls to fear of that specific thing as a separate entity, as a separate aspect. The Torah comes and breaks and shatters all of these illusions. That's what the essence of Torah is. And that's exactly what the purpose of learning Torah is. The purpose of learning Torah in the form that we have received it in this physical world is to dwell deeply, constantly sink ourselves into the soul of the Torah so that we kind of connect to that light. And that light allows us to see from one end of the world to the other end of the world. What does that mean? The first end of the world is the outer end of the world. It's the physical end of the world. The end where the illusion is the strongest, where the physicality is blocking the most. To the other end of the world, what's the other end of the world? That's the first end. That's the beginning of everything in existence. The beginning of everything in existence and the source of everything in existence is only godliness, is Einon Milvado. That's what it means that the Ohr HaGanuz, through it, Adam HaRishon could see from one end of the world to the other end of the world. The Baal Shem Tov used to use this light. People would ask him questions, and the Baal Shem Tov would open up the Zohar, and he would give them exactly the answer that they needed to know. He said that the Ohr HaGanuz is in the secrets of the Torah, because that's the essence of the Torah, it's the soul of the Torah. Everything else in the Torah is the outer embodiment, so to speak, and clothing of the Torah. Our purpose is that when we learn those parts of the Torah, and when we learn the stories of the Torah, and the halachot of the Torah, and the Gemara, and the Midrashim and all that, our intention is to learn it lishma, to learn it for the sake of connecting to its essence, connecting to that essence of light, to the Ohr HaGanuz. And so Rabbi Nachman starts off this Torah, Tetvav, Torah 15, and says, if you want to connect, if you want to experience the taste of this Ohr HaGanuz that is for the Tzadikim La'atid Lavo, these are the secrets of the Torah, the inner secrets of the Torah, meaning it's beyond, it's one level beyond the secrets of the Torah we have today. It's beyond the form of the secrets of the Torah that we have today as it's revealed in the Zohar and the Arizal. Now that there's a deeper aspect, there's a deeper meaning behind those secrets that even today we are not able to grasp yet, but there is a way that even today we can connect to those secrets of the Torah, that inner aspect, the soul of the soul, what's called the Yechida of the Torah. Yechida is the highest part of the five parts of the soul. Represents the Keter. And so Rabbi Nachman says the way to do that is by elevating and lifting up and returning the Yira to its source. Okay, and so this is very similar to the theme in the previous Torah. The theme in the previous Torah was elevating the kavod to its source, which is yira, and yira to its source, which is the heart. Right? So kavod is malchut, elevating and connecting it to yira, which is gvura, fear of Hashem, but not just a fear of Hashem, not just an outer fear of Hashem, that could be sometimes a fear of consequences. It should be a fear that's experienced in the expansiveness of the heart as an awe of Hashem. And that's elevating the yira to its source, which is the heart. That was the essence of, that was basically the summary of the Torah Yudalit. Here he's saying, by elevating the yira to its source, you may merit already now this inner secrets of the Torah, which is a taste, experiencing the taste of the Ohr HaGanuz. And so, if so, how do we do that? How do we accomplish that? And that's Ot Bet. Uvame ma'alin et ha'yira. How can we merit to elevate and return the yira to its source? Bibchinat mishpat, with the aspect of judgment, compassionate judgment. I'm going to translate mishpat as compassionate judgment. Okay, many people may learn this Torah and just say judgment, but Rabbi Nachman, if you understand from the context of the way Rabbi Nachman describes this exercise that he's going to outline in this Torah called mishpat, as self-judgment and self-assessment, you're going to see that it's a compassionate judgment. It's a judgment that comes from a place of compassion. And that's why many places in the Likutei Moharan, Rabbi Nachman points out that this aspect called mishpat is also, in the Zohar, synonymous with rachame, with rachamim, with compassion. So mishpat is compassionate judgment. But he says like this, when you... how do you lift up, elevate the yira? Through the aspect of judgment, through the aspect of mishpat. As it says in the pasuk in Mishlei, kemosh katuv, melech bemishpat ya'amid aretz. The king with the aspect of judgment will establish the land, okay? So here in this Torah, Rabbi Nachman is explaining the aspect of yira as malchut. And this is not contradictory to what we learned in the previous Torah. In the previous Torah, we were saying that Malchut is Kavod, and you have to elevate Malchut to its source, to Yira. And we were explaining that that's the aspect of Gvura. This is not contradictory to that, because Malchut, we explained in previous Shiurim, is, we have Malchut and Yisod. Yisod is more connected to the right side, the right category of Sfirot, the category of Sfirot that are more kindness, more kindness, and the Malchut is more connected to the left category, the Kav Smol, the Sfirot of judgment, the Sfirot of Yira. And so Malchut itself is an aspect of Yira. It's connected to the aspect of Yira. It itself is one of the manifestations of that energy of Yira. Okay? The king, when he rules, the experience that people have of that king ruling is fear of the king, making sure that I must follow his rules and his laws. And so that's why Malchut is this aspect of Yira. And so Rabbi Nachman says that we must elevate the Yira, we must elevate the Malchut through the aspect of Mishpat, through the aspect of judgment. As it says in the Pasuk, Melech b'mishpat ya'amid aretz, that the king through Mishpat will elevate or establish the earth, the land. The land, the earth, the midah of Eretz, what's called Eretz, is another name for Malchut. As we see, the Eretz u bechinat yira, Eretz is the aspect of fear. Kemosh katuv Eretz yare'a, that it says in Tehillim that the earth feared. Hainu, so what does it mean, this aspect of judgment, practically? How do you apply that? Hainu sheishpot et kol asakav, kemosh katuv yichalkel devarav b'mishpat. It means that he should judge all of his actions. As it says in the Pasuk, there's a Pasuk that describes this exercise. He conducts his affairs with judgment, meaning assessing that everything should be properly. A person should judge and evaluate compassionately. I will add again. A person should judge and evaluate compassionately all of his actions, ובזה יסיר מעליו כל הפחדים. And through this, by judging compassionately everything, evaluating, assessing that everything is done properly, through that a person will remove any experience of fear from things in the outer world. What does that mean? That means a person will no longer fear all of the things that he's worried about, all of the things that he's afraid will cause him harm. Lack of money, losing a job, lack of health, a sickness, whatever it is, a person will no longer fear all of these things if a person has rectified the yira. It's no longer a fear, an experience of fear of something in the outer world when you have rectified the yira. V'ya'ale b'chinat yira bara u'nekiya v'tisha'er ach yirat Hashem v'lo yira acheret. And what will happen is that now all the fright will be removed from this person's experience, and the aspect of fear will be clear and pure. It will no longer be filled with all of these distractions of the outside world. It will no longer be enclosed in all of these things of the outside world. And all that will remain is a fear and an awe of Hashem, and no other fear. And so this is why we explained in previous Yirim how Yitzchak, which is the aspect of Yira, is called Yitzchak, and the name Yitzchak is a name that means laughing. Because when you have rectified the aspect of fear of Hashem, and now there is only fear of Hashem, and no fear and awe of Hashem's greatness, and no longer fear of anything in the outside world. So everything in the outside world, it may seem fearful and worrisome. Other people may experience worry and fear of those things. To this person who has rectified the aspect of Yira, it's a joke. It's a laughing matter. That's why Yitzchak is called Yitzchak. Ki kishe'en adam dam v'shofet et atzmo. So now Rabbi Nachman is going to explain why is it that by judging yourself compassionately, okay, so the point here is the judging of yourself. Properly doing it, it means doing it compassionately. The point is not, the chiddush here is not, oh, make sure that you, when you judge yourself compassionately. That chiddush Rabbi Nachman speaks about in other Torahs, like in Torah Resh Pei Beis, for example, in other places. But here the chiddush is that you should not wait for the consequences and for the judgment to come upon a person from the heavenly court, because a person is not acting properly and is living their life in disalignment and disconnection and disaccord, to a point where a person needs to be woken up from above, from consequences. A person should not wait for that to happen. Instead, a person should constantly assess themselves and recognize what it is that they need to improve in compassionately. We must always remember compassionately. And then a person will be saved from any judgment above, because there's no place for any kitrugim, any any angels prosecuting angels from above, if the person has done the job himself of making sure, assessing and recognizing what needs to be improved and taking the initiative. And so that's what he says here. Ki she'en adam dan v'shofet et atzmo, azay danin v'shoftim oto lemala, ki im en din lemata yesh din lemala, o cheshoftim et adam b'mishpat dil'ela, azay adin nitlavesh b'chol hadvarim, b'chol hadvarim na'asim shluchim למקום לעשות בזה איש משפט כתוב, כמו שאמרו חכמנו, זיכרונם לברכה, למשפטיך עמדו, אזי הכל עבדיך לעשות דין בזה האדם. He says like this, there's a rule that is brought down in the Midrash, in Devarim, Midrash Rabbah, and Sefer Devarim, that the rule says that when there is no judgment on a person below, then there's judgment above. Meaning that if a person does not judge themselves and assess themselves here below, then there will be judgment upon him from above. But if a person judges themselves first, then a person will save themselves from the judgment from above. Okay, it's important to always remember. Also, there's another Gemara that says that kol ha-matzdik et atzmo milemata matzdikin alav et hadin milemala. That a person who makes himself a tzaddik down here that a person pushes himself and he wants himself to be very, very righteous, more than his madriga. He wants to fix himself and rectify himself and make himself a tzaddik down here, and he's very judgmental of himself because of that. A person will awaken a judgment above upon himself. And so a person has to understand how to reconcile between these two gemaras. And so that's very, very important point. And that's why the way to reconcile, the way to understand what to make between these two gemaras, that these two chazals that seem contradictory, the gemara that says, Kola mazdik tatzma demata mazdikina alav etadin milemada, sounds like a person should not make himself such a tzaddik. Don't make yourself such a tzaddik and be so medagdik and be so careful in every tiny thing to make sure that you are perfectly tzaddik, because then you awaken judgment upon yourself above. Be more accepting yourself, be more loving of yourself. That's basically the point of that Gemara. And also be open to Hashem's unconditional love. Be open to the fact that Hashem judges you favorably. Okay, that's basically the point of that Gemara. And that should not be a contradiction to this medrash here. This medrash here is only saying that if there is no judgment from below, so then there's judgment above. Judgment does not mean judgment energy. And that's why I keep on pointing out that this judgment that a person is doing is really an assessment of themselves compassionately. And if a person is doing it compassionately, so then he's not medactic on himself, he's not awakening judgment upon himself from above, he's not doing it from a judgmental energy, he's doing it compassionately, he's doing it from a place of looking at the good within himself, as well as recognizing those things that I could be doing better in. Not that I should be better in those things, right? When as soon as you say, I should be better in these things, I should have, could have, would have, I have to be better in these things, it's not my level to be lacking in these aspects, that's already judgmental energy. That's already making yourself a tzaddik. Who says you should be better in these things? Who says accept yourself the way you are? Love yourself and be compassionate to yourself and find the reasons why. You're only human. You're only human, and you have chesronot, and that's part of humility. You have lack. You have deficiencies, just like all of us. We're all flesh and blood. We're all basar v'dam. And the compassionate approach is that I have a growth mindset, and a growth mindset means that incrementally I am improving every day, small amounts, getting better, assessing, recognizing where there is room for improvement, not saying I must be and it's not right for me to be the way I am now when I should be better and this is not appropriate for me on my level, because that is what the Gemara says, that when a person goes with that energy, then a person awakens above judgment and they say, oh, you're right, really? You think yourself such a tzaddik? Let's open the books and let's see how does that hold up. How does that hold up? Let's see all these other things that are going on in your life, whether that holds up in this way that you hold yourself such a big tzaddik. And that's a judgment energy that a person is awakening. But if a person takes the compassionate approach, assessing, recognizing, judging themselves compassionately, where is room for improvement, but when you find places that are lacking, you, with kindness and with acceptance and with allowing yourself to be the way you are and recognizing that we're only flesh and blood and I am improving incrementally every day, I'm getting better and better, recognizing the good aspects in myself as well, recognizing all my places of improvement as well, right? And building myself up, building my self-esteem up, standing up for myself, empowering myself. That's part of the compassionate approach to this danet atzmo, judging yourself compassionately. If a person does it that way, a person will not awaken judgment from above. To the contrary, like we see here in the Medrash, by doing so, by having that compassionate judgment towards yourself here, down here in this physical world, in Shamayim, in the heavenly court, the prosecuting angels have nothing to say. What are they going to say? Oh, this person is whatever, whatever, whatever. Hashem is going to say, but he's taking care of it. Look, he's not ignoring it. He is taking care of it, and he has awakened here in this heavenly court a compassionate approach to those things that he needs to fix in that physical world down there, by awakening, by acting towards himself in that way. He has awakened in the heavenly court that compassionate approach as well, and he's not ignoring what needs to be fixed. And so the prosecuting angels have no place. They're completely silenced by the Rebbe. And that's the point that Rabbi Nachman wants to say here, because when you do that, you save yourself from all the worries and all the pain and suffering of this physical world, all the things that people are afraid of and worried about, sicknesses, lack of health, lack of wealth, lack of family, lack of all the things that people are worried about, you'll be saved from. Why is that? Rabbi Nachman explains that if a person did not do this, and if a person did not judge themselves compassionately, a person just ignored all their faults. So in Shemaim, there's an awakening of judgment, the prosecuting angels. And what happens is that that energy, that judgmental energy from above, is sent down and enclosed. That energy comes down to this world, and it is enclosed in all the many, many, many different things in a person's surrounding and his reality in order to be a warning sign, in order to be an awakening for that person. Hey, why are you ignoring the things that you need to fix? Why are you ignoring the Ribbono Shel Olam and his Torah? Why are you ignoring your purpose in this world? And that's when a person experiences challenges from all of these things in this world. A sickness or whatever it is, all of a sudden shakes him awake. Oh my goodness, you know, this is a time to stop for a moment. And I can't just continue living this way in that place of just ignoring, just, you know, nonchalantly just continuing in that merutzat ha'chaim, in that rat race of life. I have to stop. But if a person assesses themselves, this cheshbon ha'nefesh, this compassionate judgment, there's no place for that judgment energy above, and that judgment energy will not be sent down into all of these different things in this physical world. Instead of that, a person has elevated the judgment energy. So now there is only yira, that fear, that awe of Hashem. And all of the things in this world are going according to the wishes of this person. Nothing is resisting the wish and the intentions of this person. Everything is in alignment. Everything is in harmony. Everything is working perfectly. And the energy of awe, the energy of fear, is no longer a fear of all these many different things. It's only a fear or an awe of the greatness of the Ribbono Shel Olam. And that's this Gemara in Masechet Nedarim that says, "Lemishpatecha amdu," that for your judgment they stood, and through that, Azaya kol avadecha, through that, all of the parts of this world become your servant. Because of the judgment above, everything in this world is like a messenger, a servant, a shliach, la'asod din b'zeh adam, to fulfill the judgment that was decreed above in the heavenly court. But as we said, if you eradicate and dissolve the judgment from the heavenly court by keeping that compassionate judgment here below, if there's a judgment below, as we saw in the Medrash, there's no judgment above. And then there's no longer that the messengers in this physical world to cause fear or to implement the decree from above. That's the point that Rabbi Nachman is saying here, and we'll see the next part of that, Bezrat Hashem, in the next shiur.